Hello, everybody, and welcome to Super Geeks Mandalicious, the Mandalorian After Show, which was named by our own Carlos. It was a clever name, too. Anyways, so we're here for the third episode called The Sin, and it was a sinfully awesome episode. But everybody's here. Sean's here, but he's on break. He'll be back in a second. So I want to welcome Sun, and welcome Carlos, and welcome Justin. How you doing?
Oh.
Hi, everybody.
You got your bounty hats on, ready to collect your pucks, as they call them, I guess is what they're called.
Or fobs, depending.
Yeah, I heard pucks, but, you know, whatever.
Well, they're two different things. The fob is different from a puck.
Oh, the fobs are the... Yeah, that's true. That's different.
Fob gets you close, puck gets you there.
There you go. Now, if you guys don't mind, I decided that I want to start this time. I usually let everybody else start, but I found that I interrupt more when I do that because my thoughts haven't come out. So let me start first to hopefully prevent me not being able to help myself and interrupt people because I have thoughts. If I get them out, then it's better. So episode 3, The Sin. And Sun has just watched all of them. So I'm really looking forward to her thoughts. But let me – I only got a few thoughts. Okay. Well, I got more, but I can wait. So as far as this episode, first of all – this episode, for me, it made a big deal out of him not removing his helmet. And in the first two episodes, I thought, well, okay, they're just going to do a stylistic thing like he's never going to remove his helmet. And then what I liked about this episode is that they actually gave exposition as to why now Mandalorians don't remove their helmets because they don't want people to know their numbers because they're an endangered race. And so, and that was cool how they threw in that exposition because back during the movies, like Attack of the Clones, they're all in the Clone Wars and Rebels, they're always taking the helmets off and like they didn't care. But there's a reason they explained very cleverly as to why now they don't, because they don't, they even said we'd only one Mando at a time out in public because they don't want people to know how many are still out there because people have been hunting them down. And I thought that was great. Reason I think he's gonna, there's two reasons why I think he's gonna remove his helmet before, that's a separate thing, I'll talk about that after. But I think that was great how they did that. I love how the biggest moment of this episode isn't the one people think it's gonna be. It's not the big woo, which everybody else can talk about. It was the biggest moment for me is when he's in that shot down truck trying to get away with Baby Yoda and save him. And we know it's a him now because the scientist said him. And he was trying his best to get out of there alive with the baby. And that last moment where the camera angle and you see his face as he's trying in his helmet for crying out loud, which is great. And he looks back at Baby Yoda and you could tell that without saying a word, what he's thinking, which is, I'm sorry, I failed you. I couldn't save you. And you know, he felt, it was like he was conveying that in just that shot without his face being seen. How amazing is that? And then that big moment came afterwards, but that for me was like, wow, that they could capture that John, because John Favreau wrote all of the episodes this season, but the woman who directed this episode, Deborah Choi. She, by the way, is in charge of the entire Obi-Wan series. And I'm looking forward to that now after seeing what she could do, because her direction helped this moment and made me go, okay, I don't know who the director is. And then afterwards I found out it's not only her, but she's in charge of all the whole overall Obi-Wan series as director. And I'm like, okay, now I understand. Because I was fucking impressed. I don't know about the rest of you. But that's my big impressions I wanted to get out. And so let's go on to Carlos. What do you think?
Well, I thought it was an outstanding episode. I was confused about a few things, which I wrote about Super Geeks.
Are you still confused about it, or do you need it?
No, I mean, people explained it, and I guess it makes sense, but I still thought it was a little hinky, frankly.
Well, can you tell everybody who didn't read that for what your fears were?
Sure, I was a little confused because, you know, one minute when he's having, you know, when he brings the Beskar steel to be forged into his new armor,
right,
and the armorer makes a point of saying that, you know, all these other Mandalorians who are around are looking at him askance. And we don't know if it's jealousy. We don't know what it is, but they're all sort of moving and closing in on him. And then one of them calls him a coward. And you know, she makes a little speech and somehow that makes everything dissolve and they're all okay with him. And, you know, but they leave that a little up in the air, like exactly what the status is between him and them, even though they all, you know, intone the whole thing about the way and whatever. And then at near the end of the episode, of course, is the big surprise, the big reveal, where all is about to be lost. And just in case people are just tuning in, this is a spoiler. So
Sean, we can hear a sound.
Whatever you're okay.
doing. It sounds like someone flapping.
Yeah, that's okay. Exactly what it is.
How about if you message him so that it doesn't
interrupt my train of thought? Yep, sorry. I'm sorry.
It's less about you, more about my brain not working that well. No problem. Anyway, near the end, when all appears to be lost, and all of a sudden all of those Mandalorians appear in those cool jetpacks, which admittedly it was an awesome scene, but it's like they're sacrificing everything at that point, and it just seemed like I didn't get the very strong emotional motivation for all those guys to pick up and expose themselves publicly, which
that's fair. Obviously that's fair. Yeah.
Is, you know, I mean, it's a big deal that they're doing. He underlines it by saying, you know, now you're going to have to move to another planet because of this. And, you know, and they say, well, you know, it's the way, which is fine.
This is the way, the new catchphrase.
But if it is the way, then why did they react so negatively when he first showed up with, you know,
because of the Imperial, because it was Imperial. It was like,
Nazi gold is what it was.
Yeah. And she kind of explained it, I think, to me, that in a way that made it look differently, like, from a different, like, they look at her like they're sage. You know what I mean?
She's like the wise woman,
you know.
Do you know what this reminded me of?
What?
It reminded me of every Star Trek scene with the Klingons in the High Council. And that's what it reminded me of.
And it takes one smart person to.
If we use Mando as our analog for Worf and how he's treated like a bitch every single time he went in there.
Oh, that's good. I like that.
At the end of the day, you're still a Klingon. I mean, that's really what I kind of got that sense of, and it took somebody, you know, it took what's her name? I don't know. Do we know her name yet?
I just call her the blacksmith.
They call her the blacksmith. Yeah.
Okay, so we took the blacksmith, reminding these fuckers that we're all Klingons. I mean, Mandalorians here. And that's what it reminded me of, and I don't have a problem with it. It was cool. That was where the best analogy I could come up with because that's what it related to me. So.
Sean, I was telling everybody earlier because you because Deborah Choi, who's directed this, is going to be in handling the whole Obi-Wan. So this was her director, and that the scene where he looked like all hope looks lost just before they came to the rescue, when the camera angles where with the helmet on, you could still tell the emotion going on, where he's looking at Baby Yoda almost like saying, "I'm sorry, I failed you. I did my best before they came to rescue the cavalry." I thought that was powerful. Like, what did you think of that?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, he was. It's. I keep going back to the very last frame of the first episode when the two of them reached out like ET and touched fingers, and you knew right then and there that there was a very special bond between the two of them.
And so, keep going, Carlos. Is that all you have more to say? Or,
No. I had a bit more to say. I mean, overall, though. Past those little minor stumbling blocks I had. I thought it was a really strong episode. You know, I'm repeating a little bit about what I said in our first review, which basically that, you know, because this is so strongly focused on one character and you don't have a lot of competing subplots, it makes this a very focused narrative that that honestly is a real strength for this show. And I haven't been like, I'm not a Star Wars hater, you know. The new trilogy, the movies have been okay. I mean, I wish they would have made different choices in terms of essentially replicating what happened
original
in the
trilogy.
In the original trilogy. You know, I would have made a different choice creatively for that. But anyway, I'm not a Star Wars hater. They chose what they chose, and I've liked in general what they've done with it, but I haven't been super excited about Star Wars up until now with The Mandalorian, because it has such a strong story focus and such a strong character focus. And I think that we've seen better character building in three episodes of a half hour show than we've seen in one, you know, 3 hour movie in this newest trilogy.
Did you guys notice that whereas before it was all focused on his point of view, this episode was a little different, that it shifted and actually showed you Baby Yoda's point of view when he was in this, in the city, looking around, all the people looking at him, and how he was seeing all these things, and he was being like, kind of his curiosity is being scared.
Well, we saw some of that in chapter two as well.
We did.
Yeah, that's true. I didn't know, but I guess it was more noticeable to me this time because of the city situation.
Well, there was more of it.
Yeah.
But but there was that definite change in POV. You know, when he was watching the Mandalorian fight the, what is that thing called?
The Mudhorn.
Mudhorn, yes. You know, so there was, you know, they shifted to him several times throughout that whole sequence. So it's not new. We just saw more of it this time around. And I suspect we'll start to see more and more of it as we start to figure out, you know, who Baby Yoda really is and what his significance is and, you know, what he thinks, knows, and feels, even though he looks like a baby. He is 50 years old, so that's got to mean something.
Before we switch to Sean, because I know Sean always wants to say a lot about this, Sun has just saw all three episodes in the last couple of days, so she's fresh off the bus. Sun, let's start hearing what you think.
Okay, well, I have some things around the episodes themselves, not particularly the episodes or their stories.
Okay.
That weird silhouette opening with the Vader helm and C-3PO's head and R2's head and the swirling lights, all of that stuff reminds me more of Tron than Star Wars. And then there's the Star Wars.
I think it's just a branding thing.
Yeah.
You know?
So I don't even recall what you're talking about, but it's okay.
It's before the show actually begins.
Oh, yeah. That's a branding
thing. It's just the whole thing that's sort of like the Star Wars universe.
Oh, yeah. That has nothing to do with the actual. Now I know what you're saying. It's like when they do the Avenger movies and all that, they do that little.
You see the Star Wars characters, but it feels like the music in the background of it's like, this is going to be a Tron movie.
Well, there have only been two, so I'm not sure it's enough to constitute a stylistic, you know, separated by a few decades. So I'm not sure that
the second one sucked.
Son, let's hear what you thought of the.
Really quick on that before I forget to say this. Sure. Every time I hear it, I keep thinking that I'm hearing the opening of The Flash.
Starting with episode one, and what did you think?
Starting with episode one, it was nice to see, because I've not seen the 3D animated Clone Wars, and I've not seen Rebels or anything like that. So I hear other people have said that it's happened, but it was nice to finally see like the droid, the bounty hunting droid.
Oh, IG-11.
It's nice to actually see one of those in action.
Yep. Well, now they have the FX do it properly. So. I'm hoping they bring them back.
Amazing.
It was like ruthless.
Yes, and it was so well done. I mean, it was seamless. Yeah. If you didn't know it was CG, you wouldn't know it was CG.
Yeah, if they tried to do that way before, like 20 years, 30 years ago, it wouldn't have worked as well as it did here. You know, it would have been like, yeah.
It was so bipolar, though. One minute it's absolutely ruthless, and the next minute it's everything's hopeless. I'm going to self-destruct.
I wouldn't say that. He was just like, "Fuck it."
That whole scene with the two of them was an excellent amount of comic relief in the middle of this very stressful battle scene.
And you know why I think he's coming back, or a version of him, whether it's him repaired or a new one, is all the promo things they're showing, like for the banners and everything now, it's the Mandalorian, Gina Carrera's character who debuts next week, we'll talk about that, and him together. And so I think he's coming back and someone fixed him and reprogrammed him, or it's another.
Or it could be another droid.
Another droid, right.
Yeah, but because we're definitely seeing him in all the ads and the posters and stuff.
Yeah, so. Taiki Wakita is coming back to voice. He's the character. In some form, he's coming back. Well, I think maybe he got repaired. Who knows?
By the way, that's the guy who directed the movie Jojo Rabbit, which
that's right.
currently playing and is an excellent movie. You all
it is.
See it.
Well, I haven't seen it, but I keep hearing that.
I've read the blurbs on this and what it's about. It's like, there's part of me that says, I have to see this. And another part of me that is just so hesitant because it seems very, very dark.
It's not really that dark. There is an element of black humor to it, but it's not.
It's not dark. It's just the subject matter. They want you to be uncomfortable.
It's more the setting.
Well, that's what I mean. The setting. But, you're right. But son, sorry. Go ahead.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
Okay. Sons, episode two. Oh, well, first of all, episode one, by the end, when you saw Baby Yoda, you already, you see, this is what's different for Sons. We all saw it, like, which is what, from day one, there was no spoilers out there.
How about we let Son talk since right. you already...
Well, I'm just saying, I want to know her reaction.
Well, I know, but you're talking over her reaction.
You're right. Sorry. Go ahead, Son.
Before we even get to the whole Baby Yoda thing, it was interesting to see this... This analogy to the stolen Mandalorian steel being this analog for the Nazi gold, the stolen and recast Jewish gold from the Holocaust.
That's not a bad analogy because they do that.
Good pickup.
It is a good pickup.
That didn't even occur to me until you said it.
Exactly.
Very good. Excellent, son.
Yeah.
You're absolutely correct about
yep.
that.
Because I just rewatched certain episodes of the Ark and Rebels, and they are the race that's been, you know, the Imperials are, yeah. So
the Purge.
Yeah,
but it also,
the Purge, exactly.
It also kind
of... Damn, that's good.
This, it also lends this credence to the idea that was put forth by the bounty giver guy. That, yeah, the Empire is gone. There's just these people who have power. Well, why do they have power? They have all of this wealth and this stolen...
Well, that's what happens in real life, too. You know, yeah. Warlords.
This stolen wealth.
Yeah, they call them warlords, and that's exactly what we see, you know, in failed states around the world.
Yep. So and in war.
We get to the outpost, and everything is protecting this Baby Yoda. Why...
Well, we don't know that yet. That's the whole.
Well, we're getting hints, but
you know. Like we're told time. And, I mean, the baby is sent there. One would assume the baby was sent there to be hidden.
We have no idea why he was sent there.
It's so little nebulous, but
I mean, that's what I assume, right? That it was there to hide. That it was there to be hidden, but yet somehow somebody knew, and so they were always sending. Like mercs to kill the baby or to retrieve the baby.
And okay, so are you going by what you've seen altogether or just by one and two or which were you at right now?
I mean, just by the first one.
Oh, by the first one? Oh, yeah,
because
they...
Just by the first one, because, I mean, both the first and, you know, the first and the second one, sort of, because the Ugnaught guy himself says all of these people have come and it's made my peaceful valley this war.
Yeah. Apparently, it's not that great big a secret. So,
right.
And so by episode two's end, son, how did you feel about the Baby Yoda situation? Haven't seen what he could do. Oops, sorry. With his powers.
I'll be honest. It's reminiscent of just about every other kind of Force character ever. When Ben would use his powers in episode four, he always seemed like he got a little bit tired because he was older, right?
It expends energy, right?
Now we have this baby who's using this vast amount of power to levitate the horn monster, and it utterly exhausts him to the point of passing out for days on end.
We don't know if it was days, maybe a half hour or 30 minutes, but... I see what you're saying.
It was days because it took days for them to rebuild the ship, remember?
Oh, you're right. You're right. Yep. I forgot about the montage with the Ugnaught guy.
I also think it was and I have no evidence to back this up, but it's nice to have this headcanon that this is an Ugnaught who worked his entire life to earn his freedom from Cloud City after the Empire took over.
I don't recall him mentioning Cloud City, but maybe I missed that.
He didn't mention it. He just said...
He didn't mention it. It's just my personal
Okay.
I mean, he did mention, you know, earning his way to his own freedom.
Yeah.
He just didn't go into detail.
Interesting. Let me, Well,
dude, okay. I do have two continuing issues.
Okay.
I understand that this is a Western. So like when they have that weird horn call for the title music.
Which I love.
It's fine because it's like that kind of western, right? I understand that, but the title music itself always sucks me out of what I'm watching.
Really?
No matter what happens or what's going on, the title music sucks me out. And then even there's that when in the third episode when he brings like the bucket of the steel to the forge, the
blacksmith. She's called the blacksmith by the
way. No, she's called the armorer.
Is she? Because they call it the blacksmith and all the other. Okay.
Check IMDb. It's the armor.
IMDb. Okay.
When he brings the bucket of steel to her, the music that plays during that, I don't know why. It sucks me out as well because it happened during the first episode when he arrives back at the planet.
Hmm. Okay. Well, I guess music is.
Are you? I'm curious, son. Which piece of music is it exactly? Is it when it goes into the orchestral bit?
Oh, it's. So it's the title music with that weird horn call.
See, I love that. That's weird.
And then the one that's kind of it's weird because it's kind of it's somewhat orchestral, but then it's got this synth kind of cyberpunk underlay to it.
Hmm.
I have no idea how to describe it, honestly.
Okay, well besides the music, is that part
story,
I can,
yeah, the story cool. itself I'm absolutely enjoying.
Good, because I know that for a while you were getting like Star Wars is not interesting me anymore, and that's what's interesting about this whole topic. About go ahead.
I'm absolutely enjoying the story itself. I think the biggest issue I have with the story is some of the. I'll be honest. During the third episode, I kind of thought he had faked everybody out. He had like the scientist had pulled whatever tracker it was out of the baby Yoda, and he had wrapped that up and was carrying it off somewhere while the baby was somewhere else the whole time.
Oh, okay.
Because at certain points while he's fighting stuff, it looks like the swaddling is basically just folded fabric and doesn't have a baby inside of it, considering how in the first two episodes he's literally picked up the whole baby and there's like a huge mass to the baby Yoda.
So you thought he pulled a fake out? Okay.
Right.
I think it was better the way they handled it, but that's just me.
Oh, it's definitely, it was definitely surprised to see the way that they handled it. It just, that to me is what felt off. Now, what Carlos had a problem with the, I keep calling her in my head the Forge Mother.
Or whatever.
And honestly, that's how she portrays herself, because that whole scene with the other group is she intervenes directly because they all know they have to come to her to get.
She does seem like the matriarch of this group. By the way, it's called a covert. I found out at first. I was like, did they say coven? And it was pointed out in a podcast. It was pointed out in a podcast that they whatever term they use is called covert, right? Like covert operations.
Or the Star Wars version of Klingons.
Whatever, but the point is the term they use for this remaining group is the covert. It's something they made up for the show, whatever, but that's the term they're using.
So. Oh, yeah, I do remember that, and I was reminiscent of Coven, which I thought was interesting.
That's what I thought they said at first, but it was cleared up in some podcast. They said it's covert. And then when I watched the subtitle version, it did say covert. So
what are we looking at, Carlos?
We are looking at the actor who plays the
armor. Oh, really? Oh.
Her name is Emily Swallow. And this is from Vanity Fair. And it's an interview with her about what it's like to play the armorer, and also about how clunky it is in real life to walk around in all that armor, and that people are always bumping helmets together and stuff. There's no peripheral vision and all of that, which I think is kind of humorous. But anyway, I thought it might be interesting for people to see who it is who's actually playing this, what I think will be increasingly pivotal role in.
Yep.
At least I hope so. Because she feels like she's the only woman we've seen.
She feels like the... she's going to be the Yoda, Leia, Mon Mothma for this group. You know
I have to admit, her having that weird Spartan-looking helmet is kind of badass.
Oh, yeah, it definitely is. She looks great. for not seeing her face.
I really enjoy it. Okay, so there's a character that I'm absolutely 100% in love with, and it is basic. It's not even a minor character. It's an extra.
Oh, yeah, show that you were talking about before the show.
Would you like to see the character?
Show it. It's funny, actually. Yeah. It's funny, actually. Reminds me of a Nintendo situation. I think that's the inspiration, to be honest with you. Mario Brothers.
You're sharing it, right, son?
All right.
Oh, there it is.
You could have shared it.
What the heck?
I am in love with a toad.
It looks more like a mushroom to me.
It's Toad from Mario Brothers.
That's what I was saying,
I am in love with Toad.
Was he only in episode one? What episode was he in? I don't remember this guy. There's a lot of background characters, so.
Every time the Mandalorian's on that planet, he's in one scene.
Oh.
In the first episode, it is him. The toad guy is walking by him when he's going down that back alley.
Oh, Sean, by the way, about that, they did confirm that it's not your. We were all wondering, is it Tatooine? But they don't say it. It's Altair something L something 7. It's a new world. It's just very similar to like Tatooine, in other worlds. But
I'm glad it's a new world. I'm really sad.
It's a new world.
About Toad, this is what Toad is, okay? This is the Star Wars version of Deadmau5, is what Toad says. he's the DJ for the entire series, is what he is.
Let's go to you next, Sean.
I honestly think he's probably going to show up again and again and again in different episodes, kind of like...
Well, when he can return...
Returning gag.
He'll return one day.
Yeah, but like Morn from DS9.
he may be running away from that planet now, but we know that from the trailers, Carl Weathers comes back later, and Nick Nolte's not done, so I think he'll be coming back to that planet.
I hope that for some reason he goes with him, because he's the best character. I mean, in one episode, he created a new meme.
Well, like I told you earlier,
is using
I have spoken.
I told you earlier that it's not a spoiler, because it just, if you watch the banners and promo art for this show, it suggests that by the end of this, you got IG-11, you got Gina Carano's character who debuts next week, and Nick Nolte's character that they're gonna, and Carl Weathers too, by the way, that they're all gonna become a crew.
Look, you don't bring Carl Weathers and Nick Nolte into this show when you're launching a streaming service to do one-offs. I'm sorry, we're going to see a lot more of these two.
And I love.
I hope so. Well, we do know that a lot of celebrities are going to be associated with this show, but some of them are going to be one-offs. So,
well, Bill Burr's coming up.
We had the one off in the first episode, the very first episode. The guy who's driving that broke-ass land speeder.
Yep.
Who was he as an actor? As a celebrity?
That was just funny.
Who was it?
Was he a celebrity?
I've never known that guy's name, but he's
I never heard that was a celebrity.
He's in a lot of stuff, and he plays dumb, stupid character.
Yep. I know what you're talking about.
We know from the trailers that Bill Burr talks about in interviews constantly. He plays some kind of a mercenary where he has the shoulder laser and he's seen him shooting. We don't know if he's good or bad against Land or what, but I don't know whether he's a recurring or one shot. We'll see. But they got, you're right. They have a lot of A-list celebrities coming in and whoever. But Sean, go for it. What do you think, man?
The driver's name was Brian Boston.
I have no idea who that is.
Yeah, I'll have to look him up.
He's in a lot. He's kind of like the guy that's like he's in all the movies. He's who's the guy?
Okay, I'll take your word for it. I still have no idea who
it is. He's the guy that's in all the movies. I just became Chris Farley. Remember that movie you were in with that guy? Wasn't that great? That's how I just became right there.
He basically played a slow character in one of the Tim and Eric series.
I looked into the chat.
You know, like the Paul Rudd movies, the 40-Year-Old Virgin, those type of movies. He's the kind of guy that plays one of the buddies. He's always one of the comedic sidekick buddies in those movies, and not a major part, but He's in there for the yucks.
All right.
So here's the thing about the first three episodes. I have been watching them ad nauseum, and the reason why is because my kids are obsessed with this show, and I'm actually really kind of glad by that, because I would have thought that they would be bored to tears by this, okay? Because this is not your typical Star Wars, Star Wars fare. You know, this is a completely different approach to the franchise, and they love it. And so I'm picking up more and more things every single time I watch this. And I'm starting to realize something. I have a theory about this. And this takes us back to A New Hope, when he's sitting, when he first gets rescued, Luke first gets rescued by Obi-Wan. And they're at his place. And he says, "The Force, what's that?" Okay, which suggests that the notion of the Force, this religion, is not nearly as well known as it is as it was in the past. And I'm talking going back to Old Republic days, because remember, you know, even in the prequels, it was, you know, very clear that the conflict between the Jedi and the Sith. Going back, you know, thousands of years, it was long over, and there were no more Sith. And you know, the Jedi themselves were just considered just mystical defenders, and they don't really know much, and people really didn't really know that much about them. So I have this theory that, you know, the Force, people don't really have an idea and understanding of it. And you know, if they did, that even the bounty hunters would have been, you know, would have wanted Baby Yoda more than the bounty. Okay, and it seems to me that it's like something just switched to me. Like, they don't really understand the power of this asset, as it were, and all they know is that there are forces out there that really want him. And I have another theory too. I don't think the client was the only one. Werner Herzog. I don't think he's the only one that had a bounty out on Baby Yoda to retrieve him. Because only just by the very different approaches made by the other bounty hunters that we saw going after him. I mean, look, IG-11 was ready to cap him right then and there. So he obviously got different instructions than Mando did. Okay, so it's interesting who hired IG-11 for that job. You know, and what's the species that Bosk is?
Trandoshan.
Okay, so the Trandoshan guy. Remember in episode chapter two when he had the big fight early on with the Trandoshan, and he vaporized that one dude. If you watch that scene again, he didn't just vaporize that dude. He vaporized that dude because that dude was running after Baby Yoda to kill him.
Well, he wasn't at the bar scene when all the key fobs went off for the.
That was actually a great moment.
There's more of them coming from the trailer.
You know, how many people had a bounty out for this Baby Yoda? I mean, you know, you have all those things go off at once, and then, like, you know, yeah. Yep. So clearly, there's a lot more people trying to get after this thing. Yeah.
Right. There are different clients out there with all different motivations for what they want to be done. My theory on this is that whatever remnants remain of the Empire at this point, because we know the Resistance, or not the Resistance. What are they called? What's the
The New Republic.
The First Order.
It hasn't
risen yet, but you know, there's remnants around still. And my theory on this is that they don't want to study him. They don't want to use him. They just want him dead because of what his power means. So that's my theory on that. And this may be entirely separate from the client, Werner Herzog's motivations. And because they clearly have an entirely different agenda. And
who's the they here that we're talking about?
Yeah.
Werner Herzog and doctor, I think the doctor's name is Sheridan. Is that what his name is?
It's not Sheridan, yeah. But
it's something like that.
Something similar, yeah.
Whatever.
Wait a minute. You guys are literally retracing the first episode of this.
No, the third episode, too.
No. The first episode of Mandalicious. You literally had this exact conversation.
Oh, no, yeah, we did.
I watched it not 2 hours
ago. And Sean said, is it Sheridan? You did.
Look, I don't care what his name
is. The point is, who are you talking about when you say they?
When I say they, I'm talking about Werner Herzog and the doctor, okay? That's who I'm talking about.
Oh, I see where Sean's coming from. Sean, let me ask you if this is what you mean.
How about if Sean explains what Sean means?
They clearly have, if not, you know, more noble intentions, at least intentions that would not harm the Baby Yoda, because I mean, he was
terrified. Well, Werner Herzog doesn't appear to care one way or the other.
I'm not sure if he doesn't care. I think it's an issue of
he said extract what you need and get rid of him.
He also whispered that he was serving he mentioned some kind of superior, a mysterious superior that wants results or something of that along those lines, which suggests that he's just doing his job because he may pose as a warlord, but the secret group that may be forming the first group, because they did say the Mandalorian is going to set this up, he's part of all that and not trying to
What, I'm not sure that group exists yet. That's why I asked who you mean by they, because this is like literally right after Return of the Jedi,
5 years later.
I would like to pose something you guys may have forgotten.
What?
It's entirely possible that Warner is the sole proprietor of all these fobs.
Because he's serving a higher master. But you're right,
chiefly,
yes.
Chiefly because when the Mandalorian comes back, he asks him straight up, how many people did you send? And he goes, I needed to make sure that this job was done.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Hunting is a complicated profession.
The reason that the alive portion was even probably uttered by the guy in the first place was because the doctor was there. The doctor had bumbled the negotiation.
It's possible. But we don't have enough yet.
Don't think that's the case because they were I don't think so because they I think they, you know, it's like, look, any experiment, you'd rather have a live subject than a dead one. I mean,
But the thing
they
is,
they haven't made it clear what they're looking for.
They need something from its body, and once obtained, the body is not necessary.
Yeah, they said extract the material and then, like,
wait a minute. There's an explanation for that. There is an explanation for that line. That is literally the doctor making an excuse to keep the child alive, because later, when the Mandalorian comes in, he goes, it's just a baby. Right. I wanted to save it.
But video that the Mandalorian zoomed in on when he was doing the listening thing with his mask when he was on the rooftop, he heard the leader guy. What's that guy's name? The German guy that plays him.
He's just the client.
Anyways, he says, extract what you need. So-and-so needs it.
Right.
And it wasn't the doctor that said that.
Yeah, that was the client.
It was Herman, whatever his name is, the actor.
Werner Herzog.
Werner, sorry. By the way, no offense. I don't know who this guy is. Everybody seems to know.
He's a very famous director.
I got in that respect.
Who does some acting, but he's like one of the world's most renowned directors.
Okay. And I appreciate that. I'm just saying, like, I don't want to sound like a dick, but everybody's saying this guy's famous all over the internet. And I'm like,
it's a big deal that he's in it.
Well,
that's cool. I like that. I just never heard of him. I mean,
there is IMDb, George.
I'll do that. But I'm just saying, like, when he was zooming in and doing the audio eavesdropping.
Yeah, yeah. You explained that.
Yeah, yeah. He said that you need to extract the whatever.
Yeah, and you just said that.
After that, so he didn't care what happened to the baby, basically.
So I also do expect that we're going to see the doctor show up again. I mean, and join up with.
I don't know about that.
I mean, look, I think he's a key to this puzzle, is what
he
I think.
He is a key. Yeah, I think you're right about that, yeah.
Totally. We're going to see him again.
And I would not be surprised if this takes the turn of the baby is now that he's in custody of the Mandalorian, that he's sick. he's not well, and so they're forced to go back to the doctor to find out it's to possible. Have him treat him.
Well, so, I mean, that's not a bad idea, but at this point, it's utter speculation.
Yeah,
sure.
There's just not enough information to really get too deep. They've given us just enough to get to form theories, but not enough to really show on.
I really, really do not want this show turning into Firefly. I'm sorry,
it's not. Don't. Jon Favreau said this is based off.
Guys,
Jon Favreau said that not only. Jon Favreau said in a recent interview, it's not just spaghetti westerns that he directed everybody to say this is what it's based off of. It's also based off the, I forget the name of the famous director, but it's the Japanese westerns. That's why Lone Wolf. Yes, him. That was his biggest inspiration. That's why we're seeing Lone Wolf and Cub type. Well, we talked about that last week. That the baby and the samurai. That's a theme in those Japanese spaghetti westerns.
Yeah.
So that's all I'm saying. Specifically
you, George, you're making it out like there's going to be this big, huge ensemble cast on a ship.
No,
like with the bounty droid and
well, no, I think that is going to happen. Because the artwork for the show depicts an ensemble. So,
oh my god,
does this depict just the Mandalorian?
And if it's based off the Japanese, like the name that Sean just threw out, Akira that's what's going to happen. They always, his style is you meet the individuals, they get to know each other, then later they do form a group, and that is actually a theme. That which is why later, yes, I think by the end of the season.
If you remember, though, if you remember any of the interviews with George Lucas, that was George Lucas's inspiration for Star Wars in the first place.
Part of
it was only one of many. The World War II era serials were also an inspiration.
And King Arthur.
I don't think you can put too much on any single source.
Right, but in this case, Jon Favreau instructed. Pedro Pascal said in an interview, he mentioned, how do you want me to play the character? And he said in the interview, he mentioned the name. Again,
Akira
I can't.
Kurosawa.
I'll just say Kurosawa. Is that good enough?
Yeah, that's fine. I won't remember. Kurosawa.
All right. So Kurosawa, John, people keep quoting that name. And that he said, the Clint Eastwood man with no name, spaghetti westerns, and Kurosawa.
Yeah, basically the Magnificent Seven is what we're talking about,
yes.
Which is based on a Kurosawa film.
Yes,
which is the Seven Samurai, right?
Yes. Which means we're going to see more people added to this ensemble.
Exactly,
we just are.
And as I said, the baby it inspires the famous anime or manga. I'm sorry, Lone Wolf and Cub, which is a samurai westernish story about a samurai guy who is a mercenary killer who goes out and does his job until his job is. To get a baby, but he ends up bonding with the baby and saying, no, I'm going to protect him now, and taking the baby and making him the two of them, and that's exactly kind of a recreation of what they're doing. And that was very apparent from the beginning. By the way, one of the things people point out is that foundlings is what the Mandalorians call orphans, and people kept saying, oh, he's a mercenary with a heart of gold. Not necessarily. The flashback sequence this was very telling in this episode. The flashback sequence that they showed up until the cliffhanger flashback sequence was leading up to a foreshadowing why he was going back for that baby. I didn't think about it in hindsight until someone pointed out on another show I watched is they were showing you just enough in hit while he was having that like that guilt and he's going, I got to do the right thing. Because he was with the blacksmith, or sorry, the armorer, and he was having those flashbacks while she's banging out the armor of what he went through as a kid. But guess what? Here's what's interesting. Where did they leave off on his flashback? He was about to be killed during the Clone Wars by that super battle droid, but we don't know who saved him. Now, I have a theory about that. I want to throw that out real quick before I move on to see what Justin thought. I think it was a Jedi. Because it is during the Clone Wars. And the reason I think it's a Jedi and not just someone that shoots it and saves him is because, and I told you guys ahead of time, bear with me and don't like, I think this is a foreshadow so that later, if he does meet Luke, he'll go, a Jedi saved me when I was a kid. Come on. It's going to happen.
No.
It's not going to be Luke, dude.
No.
It will be Luke.
Okay, wait a minute.
It's going to be Luke.
No. I don't know what has in this.
No, it's going to happen.
I don't know what I after the first three episodes, this is so far removed from.
Is it really? Look at the flashbacks.
Yes. Wait, Clone Wars. Wait a minute.
Yeah, but those were fought over a huge swath of the galaxy, right. Dude.
And you have a kid with the Force, and you don't think Luke's going to come in later?
Wait a minute. I have a much better answer for this.
Luke is not coming.
He's coming.
I have a much better answer to settle George. Why do they need Luke when they
don't need him?
Wait, let me finish your question.
Why do they need Luke when they literally already have a Jedi in Baby Yoda?
That's my point.
Okay,
that's the reason why Luke.
Well, that's one of the fundamental flaws of this show, which is one of the topics we're slated to talk about today.
In our next segment. Look, we're talking about a connection to events within the Star Wars universe. Having this connect to, direct characters like that specifically in this universe, they've gone out of their way to not do that with this. So I don't see.
It's only been three episodes.
But I know that. They've established this, though, that this is what they're doing here.
But Sean, is Dave Filoni, what has he done on his shows, Vader? He waited till season two, but...
Okay, right, but this is not the same show, though. This is not the same style of show. This is so completely removed.
Okay, well, we'll see. There's no way to know until it happens, if it does or doesn't happen. I believe it will, but...
You look at the Clone Wars, you look at Rebels, okay, and you look at two series that were directly tied to those characters, to those well-known characters.
From the get-go.
If we see anybody, it will be Obi-Wan.
Obi-Wan's dead, dude.
Justin, take your meds.
In a flashback.
Actually, that is not bad. No, wait a minute.
To the Clone Wars.
No, that's good. I actually am rethinking
the foundling.
I'm actually shocked.
I don't see them doing Luke because that's too high.
Hold on, I'm going to give you some credit, Justin.
But
you just made me you
somebody else.
You well, just for made one me know Luke
wasn't
worked.
Alive.
I no right, but he's right. If it's Obi-Wan, it makes sense because this takes place around this flashback is in the Clone Wars.
Yeah, no, we get it.
And
we
who could have saved him? They could have brought Ewan to do. I like it, Justin.
I think that's a valid
somebody else say Yoda saved him, but I doubt no,
that's
I
not that's
Yoda
not impossible
that.
Either. That's not impossible either. Because they were both around.
In my mind, he would have recognized Baby Yoda, what Baby Yoda was immediately.
He never said that he did or didn't, though.
He didn't know who it was. He didn't know why it was.
If he didn't say he didn't know the species,
Yoda,
though.
He would know that it's an important thing.
No, right. Race-wise, I'm just saying.
It's not even a matter of that. He came right out and said when he was asked what happened by
and he says, I don't know.
I said, I'm still not sure is what he says.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. And so, this is, I think this is all, like I said, this goes back to my theory about people not really understanding, universe.
Well, he might have only seen the lightsaber slash against the droid. He might not have seen the Force being used.
What? I'm not even talking about that. I'm talking about...
Mom?
George,
I'm,
go ahead.
I'm talking about the Mudhorn. After the Mudhorn, and when he says to him, that what happened. He says, I'm not really sure. And this goes back to my theory about this notion of that the Force isn't really, pervasive universally. People really don't have an understanding of it.
But the thing is, I think people know of the Force. They may not know particulars about it because may the Force be with you is an expression that people use generally. So it has some mythological underpinnings that people get enough, even if they don't quite understand origin of it.
Look at Force Awakens with Rey and Finn. They heard about all this shit, but they didn't know if it was real. Han said it's real.
Well, aren't they getting ready to do an Obi-Wan movie here for too long or...
It's a series.
Or was it series?
It's a series.
That's another reason why I think we might wind up seeing them.
And I think that's a good reason, Justin. I mean, because it makes sense for them to pitch Obi-Wan as perhaps the one who saved.
I agree. I never thought about that, but it makes total sense.
Because that's also a tie-in to an upcoming series. Whereas with Luke, it doesn't make sense.
No, what I meant was a foreshadow to him seeing Luke later and saying, a Jedi saved my life. I just thought maybe that,
if we... even get a Luke reference, it'll probably just be in a reference. We are most likely to see something in the Relay to Obi-Wan because of the new series, because they're going to want to promote both. That.
They'll do one and the other. They're not going to waste the opportunity during this time period to not include Luke. I'm sorry. Maybe not this season.
Sorry, George, but that's not wasting it. That's establishing its own.
Okay,
right.
What they're going to do is.
But that's not what they've done in the past.
Here's the thing. They are. Look. Lucasfilm is specifically closing out the Skywalker franchise.
Yep.
This is all.
Is so adamant about killing off the old guard.
Right. Exactly. There's absolutely no reason to make any connection.
All right. Well, we'll see.
And here's the thing.
We can argue it all we want, but we won't know till we see.
You gotta remember, when the Clone Wars the series was on, that was supposed to be the last Star Wars we were ever going to see, okay? Before Disney bought Lucasfilm, okay? So it makes sense to have those connections, especially within the Clone Wars, which is directly tied to the prequel trilogy. So it doesn't make any sense when they're specifically closing out the Skywalker franchise to shoehorn him in there.
It would be shoehorning.
Here is why they're going to do Obi-Wan. George, you watch CW. How do they introduce new Arrowverse characters?
I already agree with you on the Obi-Wan thing. You don't have to justify it.
Hang on. That's what I think Disney is going to do, because they're going to take that formula and do it with the Obi-Wan. And if anything, Luke might be a reference within the Obi-Wan show, or Anakin might be a reference within the Obi-Wan show. We will have to wait and see.
There's no way we can know until
but it won't be Luke. It'll probably be Anakin.
I don't agree with you. I'm sorry, guys. Anyways.
Now, here's the fascinating thing. We have actually changed George's mind a little bit.
He changed my mind who it is that rescues
Wait a
minute. Do you know why we've changed it just a little bit? Because, yes, he's still adamant Luke is going to show up, but now he wants us to wait and see instead of constantly railing that it's
going to happen. I guess that's progress. Season one finale.
All right, then.
Season one finale. So, Justin, what did you think of the episode?
I loved it. I mean, the part where towards the end where, all the Mandalorians showed up. I don't know, but I really think that the Mandalorians is the Star Wars answer to Klingons.
Yeah.
I mean,
They're similar. They've always been.
They got the honor code.
This is the way. I like that. Yeah.
Very specific weapons that only Mandalorians use.
It just fits.
Hopefully they don't turn
good.
As cheesy as the Klingons did.
The thing that the Mandalorians had no back lore or culture until Dave Filoni started all that, and Jon Favreau was involved with Clone Wars and then Rebels. So that's why they picked them to do this show, because they created the lore more recently. The lore never existed until less than 10 years ago. So otherwise, it was just a matter of Lucas saying they're a warrior culture called the Mandalorians. And he was part of grooming giving Dave ideas on how to shape and form. The only thing that Lucas ever wrote that was used in Rebels by Dave Filoni is that originally he said their homeworld was called Conquered Dawn. They use Conquered Dawn in Rebels, but it's not their homeworld. It's like their next
planet. Right.
And then Mandalore is the original plan. But other than that, he
that's
gave...
fine. I think George Lucas plays no role in it.
He mentored Dave Filoni.
It's nothing but an angry, old, bitter person. No control over nothing.
You don't need to go down that road.
The only difference is he's still alive, number one. And number two, he did mentor Dave Filoni to get to this point.
But I do have to also agree. I think we're going to see an ensemble joining the crew, Mandalorian, here later on. I don't know if it's going to be a whole bunch of people, because that ship's not very big.
Three or four.
Unless they get another ship.
The droid, maybe three people. Carl Weathers, Gina Carrera, who's coming next week, and Nick Nolte. That's not a big crew.
I don't think Carl Weathers is going to end up being his friend.
I
think he's going to be his constant nemesis.
In the trailer, he's next to Gina Kerr and Nick Nolte's characters at one point. But you're right.
Doesn't mean anything.
Yeah, he could still be a frenemy. You're right. He could be. He could be the Jabba the Hutt. you know.
He's a Jean Valjean of
who? I'd like to
to blame his res preference.
Okay, you will do this. I have spoken.
What?
I want to point out something that I found particularly funny, like
what?
The Calamarian squishy money was funny.
Oh yes,
yeah, that was funny.
Flume, flug, or something like that.
But here's a deeper thought question, because this was something that I found strange. Is it possible that our Mandalorian is part cyborg?
Nah.
I have to ask this question because the same tool that he's using to repair the circuitry on his damn armor is the same tool that he was shoving in his fucking arm.
He was burning. He was that burning off his wound. He was cauterizing.
Yeah.
By the way, Justin, can you put up a spoiler alert before I say my next thing?
Okay, hang on.
All right. I watched an interview with Pedro Pascal today, and people asked, are we ever going to see you take the helmet off? And he said, yes. He said,
of course we are.
And he mentioned that if you pay attention to episode
helmet.
Yep.
Chekhov's helmet.
Yes. And he said, if you pay attention to episode 3, he said, they bring it up and make it a thing because later he's going to say, let's change it and be brave.
Yeah.
Well, this is exactly what I was going to mention that I suspect is happening. We're going to see, and I think what we're going to see is him leading an uprising of the Mandalorians of having,
I think he's going to get the Darksaber, Sean. Fear.
Okay, well, who knows? Maybe it's possible.
It's Dave Filoni. I'm just saying.
I mean, it could be, but I don't think that's necessarily that big of a deal. It was a big deal for like one episode of really the Darksaber
on Rebels. It was recent.
But it wasn't that big of a it wasn't that big of a plot point.
Well, either way,
I mean, the bigger issue here is that they're able to come out of the shadows, and he's going to lead the revolution.
Exactly,
I think, is what I see. You know? Yep. So, Carlos, your thoughts on that?
Well, I think that makes a lot more sense because it's something that's centered around that character as opposed to trying to force fit it into the lore.
It might be the last scene of the show.
He said force.
And also said lore. So, so I, you know, that makes a whole lot more sense to me. Because it's all connected and it's not going too far afield and trying to shoehorn it into other parts of the
this show is called The Mandalorian, okay? So it's not called
excuse to put in characters we've already met before.
Exactly, right.
So, I agree with you guys. I'm not trying to sound too fanboy.
You're
sounding totally fanboy.
You are.
It's a challenge.
What's clear is that him being a Mandalorian is just as important to the series as our subplot.
I like the Worf comparison earlier.
I did.
I like that because you and Son both made some incredible observations. Well, Justin did too. I'm just saying that, like, the Worf trying to get acceptance thing, I'm starting to sense, I'm looking back now at the first two episodes, I'm like, it does feel like that.
Yep.
Like he's trying to reclaim his heritage. Okay, before we move on to the next subject, which is going to be about something Son wanted to bring up earlier that was a Trello subject about, as an afterthought, now that we've all given our basic reviews, I want to play something to make everybody kind of smile because this made my day. All right. So
Okay.
Hang on.
Here we go.
Let's get ready.
It's a 1 minute thing. So everybody be patient.
Master Yoda, you survived. Your arrogance blinds you, Master Yoda. Now you will experience the full power of the dark side. I have waited a long time for this moment, my little queen friend. You will not stop me. Darth Vader will become more powerful than either of us.
Yeah. All right, that was fun.
Baby Yoda's going to win. Just saying.
I don't think he would, actually. But
he's cute.
You know, the thing that was interesting to me about that was Sidious's whole thing about Darth Vader will become more powerful than either of us. When in fact he doesn't, he still totally owns Darth Vader in
Return
of the Jedi.
Return of the Jedi.
Yeah,
he totally owns him.
Yeah, the fact of the matter is that as much as he wanted Darth to go over completely, Darth never really did, because he wouldn't have tossed him down that hole if he had. So you lose.
He would have.
So we had a subject that was a
safe subdued to overthrow your master.
There was a recent Twitter thing where Anita Sarkeesian. Before we go there,
can we talk about the other topic that we had, which was the whole extended universe problem that the
go ahead, Carlos.
Mandalorian.
Thank God.
And
that's on our show. Yeah, I forgot about that. Go ahead.
Yeah, basically, this is from. From an article that was on Forbes Online. And the author there basically was saying that, you know, these are both great things, Fallen Order and The Mandalorian, except that when you try to fit them into the bigger context of the story of Star Wars, you know, there is no Baby Yoda in the third trilogy. You know, and I don't know Jedi Fallen Order well enough to know what parts of that don't seem to fit in with what we see later in those other.
I'll explain after you get done.
Sure. And, you know, and I think it's a valid point. I mean, I read one guy on Collider who basically said, look, y'all better get ready to watch Baby Yoda die at some point, because we don't see Baby Yoda unless I'm not done yet.
Sorry.
Unless he says, and he says this sort of tongue in cheek, but he says, Baby Yoda is Snoke. It's a theory. He says, I'm still workshopping it. But it actually, that would make sense if there's something about, you know, Baby Yoda turning into the dark side.
We'll hear about Baby Yoda in the future.
I don't want to interrupt anybody, so I want to say something.
It's like this. It's a big universe, okay? It's a big universe. Maybe... I mean, I don't necessarily subscribe to the notion that that we're going to lose Baby Yoda. He's going to get killed. Maybe Baby Yoda just goes and finds Yoda's old house in Dagobah and just hangs out there forever just to stay the fuck out of this shit.
Sean, is it really...
That doesn't make any sense to me at all.
There's a really simple explanation Sean will understand.
I want that to happen.
But Sean, you watched all the Clone Wars and Rebels.
Yes.
And you know what Dave Filoni, how he is.
Yes.
Here's why this article makes me go, shut up, guys. The thing is that it has to do with both Fallen Order and what the Baby Yoda thing. Dave Filoni, when he made the Rebels series, had two Jedi characters that theoretically everybody knew from the beginning. Well, Kanan and Ezra can't possibly survive because there's no other Jedi except Luke and Leia in the Return of the Jedi period. So these guys, this takes place several years before, so they have to die. And everybody assumed that they were going to die. Well, nope, guess what? Dave Filoni found a clever way to work around that. He did have Kanan die, but he had Ezra warped off with Thrawn to another galaxy with space whales, and he was out of the picture, so he was not interfering in the whole prophecy thing.
That's
Dave Filoni,
as good as killing him off.
Okay, yeah. Right. But the point is he did plan this out. He talked about it. He knew people were going to flip out if they were still alive during the time Luke was there, because, you know, Luke is supposed to be the only one left. But found
you're making it seem like.
Hold
it's
on,
this...
let me finish. I know what you said, ahead. But let me finish first. So then, going back to Fallen Order, okay? Everybody's freaking out because, not freaking out, the conversation is the same thing. This takes place a few years, I think it's like 3 years after the Revenge of the Sith, right? So you get this main character and his mentor, and the lady who's like his, not mentor, but she becomes like his mentor. And the two of them are the last two remaining two Jedi left. And this is like way before Rebels, like early Revenge of the Sith time. Luke is like 3 years old or 2 years old at this point. And everybody's going, well, obviously they have to die. If they live, they screw up the whole timeline. The whole point of this article pisses me off because they're not giving the writers the benefit of the doubt that they already thought of that and that they have a plan ahead of time. So this article, you're not giving the writers any credit. That's my point. Baby Yoda, same idea.
I'm actually on George's side on this. Is that
he's proven it?
It's speculative.
What is it you think he's actually proven, though? I don't.
He's proven that he's thought that the writers can think about they're doing it in a time period where they shouldn't have.
I doubt that anyone that they've thought about it. I mean, that's not my point.
They're not going to like suck up the cannon.
George, you're totally misunderstanding my point. Okay, I don't give a crap about canon. I give a crap about the introduction of what appear to be super important characters who obviously end up not being that important because we don't see them.
Well, we talked about this last week.
I know, but we never resolved it. I mean,
Baby Yoda's too young, even in The Force Awakens.
Okay, here's the thing about this, though. This is what I'm saying. It's a big universe.
It is.
Okay.
What you're saying when you say that is the same thing as George, which is there are convenient places to send them so that they're out of the big action.
Well, and
but the point is, why are we going to invest so much into these characters that they end up not being that relevant?
Who says they're not relevant? They're just not that relevant.
Because we don't see them.
Okay,
He's a toddler in Force Awakens.
My point, George,
that's 25 years later.
So what? 50 years is a baby, dude.
But Yoda's over 800 when he died.
I would like to point out something.
Go ahead, son.
Baby Yoda is in no way a Jedi and or a Sith.
Not only that, but he's 50 years old as a baby. If 25 more years,
you don't know the speed at which they develop, George.
He can't be part of the Sith Jedi dynamic if he's not one.
I'm just saying that.
Well, that part's true. Also, you're right, son.
I'm just saying that. Just have faith in the writers is all I'm saying.
Right.
Because there doesn't seem to be. Look, who would have thought that the resolution on Discovery would be to send them all, you know, how many, 1,000 years into the future. Who would have thought the way to go on that?
Hey, Carlos, by the way, I just want to point out, your arguments are valid.
I swear to God.
I'm just saying, I recognize all the arguments here in the article. I get it, but from people who have seen Dave Filoni at work and people like him,
you're sidestepping my point, George.
You're not letting anyone get their point across, George.
Yeah, Baby Yoda.
Hey guys, I'm gonna have to cut it short here. I'm past my allotted time.
All right, no problem.
Okay, buddy. Right,
so I'll catch you guys later. Okay.
Good luck with the rest of the move, Sean.
Thank you.
Have fun.
See you again, Sean.
Well, all right, Carlos. Explain to me how I'm. Go ahead.
Okay, because again, I listen carefully to what I'm saying.
I'm
not saying that Dave Filoni isn't a smart guy. I'm not saying that he can't find some convenient way to send them somewhere else. My point is the fact that we don't see them in the final trilogy means that they're no longer playing an active role in the overall saga, which means one of two things. One, he has just moved them somewhere else, like he has with the other examples you've given us, or they have died. And maybe they've died in such a way that sets up that's a sacrifice that sets up an ultimate victory by the good guys. But the fact of the matter is that that character is gone.
Wait a minute. Sorry, Justin. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Maybe they're trying to do an alternate universe.
Oh, that's just ridiculous.
All right, Justin. Maybe we shouldn't want to talk. No, I'm just kidding. No, it can't. Go ahead, son.
No, let him finish. Let him finish.
Oh, no, go ahead. I'll just get interrupted and get told to shut up.
I didn't tell you shut up. I was joking anyways. Go ahead, son. Justin, I'm sorry. Are you, keep going.
No, go ahead. I'm done.
I was just joking.
Please, I'd like to hear what you have to say.
Well, I mean, you know, let's think about it. I mean, you know, Disney owns the franchise now. They're going to want to continue the stories and do something different from what Lucas already did.
I don't understand the point of that, though.
Well, I mean, you know, it's possible. It's better than sending him off somewhere off or killing them to die.
And see, that's...
That's what he's done already. George's whole point is that this is what Dave Filoni has done. So that makes more sense to me than an alternate universe that comes out of, literally out of nowhere.
True.
My big question in all of this is, why do the Mandalorians and Yoda have to play a part in the big three movies? Why?
That's a fair argument.
That's fair too.
No, I mean, I think that's an excellent question, son. But that's exactly my point. Is that obviously Baby Yoda has some big importance because so many people want him. So if we don't see him in the third movie, or in the final trilogy, that means that whatever that purpose was either failed in some way. You know, either it was killed or it sacrificed itself for some greater good or whatever, but they're simply not there.
Or, well, you could be right, Carlos.
It doesn't make any sense for Baby Yoda to still be alive and be unimportant.
But we're assuming, though, that he was meant to play that bigger role. We don't know yet.
This is probably a Filoni thing, maybe, but there's an easy out for that. And the Mandalorian brought Baby Yoda back. Guess what ended the bounty contracts across the galaxy? The fact that the bounty was turned in. Everyone still had their fob for the Baby Yoda thing because they were all pissed that they didn't get the bounty.
They're getting pinged. That's true.
That was the whole reason everybody found out they had the ping.
Well, they still will get pinged unless he removes it, if you can find it.
How does that even work? Does anyone know?
No. The ping only works in proximity.
Yeah, that's true. The range can't be hyperspace.
As long as Baby Yoda is with the Mandalorians, and the Mandalorians are in hiding somewhere, nobody's ever going to go looking for the baby because nobody knows where the baby's at.
And we don't know the range, so...
a Mandalorian has supposedly already turned in the baby.
But the baby has a tracker, don't it?
That's what we're talking about, the range on that thing.
That's the fob.
See, that's what they haven't explained. Like you could go looking for him, and then if you get close, you'll get the ping. Unless you can find that implant tracking, whatever it is. It can't be the crib. I thought it was the crib at first, but he doesn't have the crib. So it must be in the baby.
Or I wonder if maybe the Mandalorian doesn't have a tracker on him. Maybe they're tracking him.
We need to know more about what...
There's not enough information. You're right.
The pucks and the fobs work.
You guys were arguing back and forth. It just hit me why the Mandalorian is so drawn to the child, to the kid.
Because the kid is a foundling. He was exactly. A foundling.
He's an orphan him.
No. He found the foundling.
Right, yeah. But he's an orphan, and he recognizes...
But they're both foundlings.
They're both foundlings, right.
They're both foundlings, but he found
him. There's no but. I mean, it's an and.
It's a whole orphan and foundling type.
He's a baby of a species that obviously his parents aren't around. He's been captured, or he's doing whatever, and he doesn't have his people around him, and he can relate to that based on the flashbacks. That's why the flashbacks did that leading up to his decision to go back and get him. But let's talk about one last subject before we wrap up. Because Sun brought this up, and it was a good one, so we don't have to make it long. But there's a lot of Twitter talk and about feminists getting upset about how we haven't had any females.
God, yes.
But here's the thing, and then I'll let Sun carry off with this. They say all this, but it's like I don't know if it's the helmet, but they forget like the armorer. It has been in every episode so far, and she's been a key character, and she's a female, but they don't mention her.
Here's the bad thing. And they get pointed out about this, and they ignore it. They're ignoring it completely.
They are. And let me let Sun take from this, because it was her idea for this subject. So, Sun, carry on. What were you going to say about that you wanted to talk about?
So feminist activist Anita Sarkeesian went on a Twitter rant about the first couple of episodes
of Gamergate fame, just for people who don't remember.
Of the first couple of episodes of The Mandalorian, and screeching about how there was zero female representation at all whatsoever in The Mandalorian, how every character was male that we'd come across. That would be fine if it was true. It was pointed out rather quickly, the armor lady is a lady.
Right.
Basically the forge mother of the entire, you know, sect of the Mandalorians on this planet. And Sarkeesian from there shifts her goalposts and say, well, there's still not enough women in this show. And okay, sure, that's a fair point.
So far.
To act like there was no women in the first place is kind of disingenuous because it was there. It was there.
Well, now, the argument was they kept saying not till 30-something minutes in or whatever.
Oh, that's bullshit. Because first of all, it was only 39 minutes long. So it wasn't that long, you know. And secondly, Sun is absolutely right. I mean, there was, because I did hear this first. I'm like, but wait, the armor was clearly a woman. So what's the deal? That said, you can't say just so far dismissively, George, because we're 3 episodes in on a 8-episode season. No, so we're almost halfway through.
Yeah, that's
now,
true.
But we are getting a new major female character in the next episode. So it's not like there isn't any, you know, I think it's going too far to say what Sarkeesian said, but it's not going so far as to say that it's been pretty penis heavy so far.
Like, you don't even see you know what's funny? Hold on, before you say, what's funny is he's the main character, but you can tell he's male, but you don't see him. So he's the man, DeLorean. No, I'm just kidding. But anyways, go ahead.
Bad joke.
I'm sorry.
Boo.
I had to make a funny.
Not funny.
Basically, in response to this, Anita Sarkeesian was ratioed hard on Twitter. And for those who don't know what ratioing is, it's when more people comment on a Twitter thread than they do share the Twitter thread.
That's why I try to stay away from Twitter. I really hate it. But
It basically means more people didn't want to put up with your shit than they blindly retweeted what
you said. How was I going to say? In it.
But this also brought in quite a few people harassing Sarkeesian, and that's not okay.
And that is not okay.
You're right.
She can still be wrong without having to be harassed.
Right. And granted, there is a divide where she can take criticism. She can expertly take criticism and turn it into harassment magically. I don't know how. I don't know why.
I haven't noticed her do that in response unless I missed it, but. Her followers, of course, but...
And she has a group of rabid fans and followers who will harass other people based on her. And that, too, is not okay.
You know, to be fair... Go ahead, sorry.
Don't understand why people think it is 100% okay to harass people on Twitter. Or anywhere.
It's Twitter.
On the internet in general. If you have a critique of somebody, post your critique. If you agree with that person's critique, okay. If you don't, well, guess what? Be civil and critique their critique. That's okay, too.
That's the way it used to be back in the day, but now it's like, you can't say an opinion without getting 20 people responding, telling you how you're wrong and which way you think you should do it and how they think you should tie your shoes.
I don't have a problem with that. I only have a problem with people saying, there's something wrong with you for believing that. I mean, that's a whole other level. Telling people they're wrong, I have no problem telling people they're wrong. I don't have a problem with people telling me I'm wrong. I have a problem with people saying, you're wrong because you're a terrible person. That's a whole other thing.
I want you to fall out of the world in Minecraft.
Well, the thing I notice is that the response when she and her and people and other people that were feminists were saying, because to be fair, and I'm gonna offset this with some fairness. All the feminists and her that says something, the first thing they say is they love the show. Now that's a little different than some in the past when people would just go after something for not being representative enough. But they start off by being kind about the source material. They say with a however, but at least they give some. Hey, the show's good. However, it would have been nice to see, in all honesty, the shit I read that she said, it wasn't like what people are making it out to be. She said, I love the Mandalorian, but it would be nice if there had been a female that didn't take this long to show. She never ripped on the Mandalorian. She likes it. She just said, this would make it better for me. Honestly, that was pretty soft.
That's fair.
I mean, come on.
And here's a problem I have with that.
Why? What is it?
They've been hinting that the female character was coming. They've even got it on the
background.
Yeah,
but she's talking about up to this point, this many minutes in and all that.
Background. Right. They've had it on the background the whole time.
Right, but what Carlos just said a little earlier was true, though. That's not the point. They're arguing that it takes this long to get your first female on screen. But be honest, honestly, they do say kind things first and say, we like the show, they support it. And then they offer their, like, but if it could be better for me if blah, blah, blah. It's a criticism. They're not saying I'm shitting on the show just because.
But they've had two females on the screen already.
That's not the point. I know that they were wrong. My point is that
and she admitted she was wrong.
She
said she missed it.
Oh, did she? Good, good. Yeah. I didn't catch that part.
Yeah,
I'm just saying people jumped.
She tweeted she went to bed and then came back after she'd already explained. Oh, I missed it because I was really tired and I didn't see it because you don't see a face behind the armorer's helmet.
I can see that.
You know, she admitted she was wrong, but she still got 3,000 people who were yelling at her. So that's where I think Sun's point is is exactly to the point, which is you know, they're just harassing her as opposed to just disagreeing.
The jump on responses from the people who are ready to jump on her were typical feminists. You're ready. You were waiting to jump on this, but that's, if you really read the tweets, that's not what's happening. They were the first thing, not just her, tons of other feminists. They were saying, it sucks because they didn't have females, you know.
And it's understandable. It is understandable to a great degree.
Overreaction.
I think the biggest problem with Sarkeesian herself is the fallout from Gamergate.
All right, well, let's not get too far off the side about that, but yeah.
I'm not trying to get off into the weeds, but I think that is the biggest reason.
So we don't have to hear Darth Vader thing. Thanks, Justin.
It's I honestly believe most of the hate that Sarkeesian gets, just Sarkeesian. I don't know if any other person who's made the same critique, even with being pointed out that they were wrong, has received as much of a ratioing as Sarkeesian has.
Honestly, paid attention to her other than the first Gamersgate, now this.
And honestly, I honestly believe that the reason she did get ratioed so hard is because of her involvement in Gamergate.
Oh, no, of course. Yeah, that makes total sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As someone who wasn't even a part of Gamergate when Gamergate happened and having been accused of being on one side or the other of Gamergate, I don't give a shit about Gamergate. I call out bullshit when it's bullshit.
Yeah, no, you're very fair about that, Son. But the reality is that she herself just existing is a hot button for a lot of people. Yeah.
They're ready to jump on it.
And here's the thing. Here's the thing for those people. When you harass her, you continue to make her existence possible. Stop.
Not only that, how quickly they jumped on her, they had to have been following her because it wasn't like a hashtag, I think, that made them see it. It was like they were watching for it, you know.
Of course, hate watching is a thing.
Yeah.
How many people do you think watch all kinds of news just to hate watch whoever they're watching?
All right, let's wrap it up because this show is meant to be just mostly a reaction to each episode. This topic was a good one though because it is news. Is there any other news? Oh, Carlos, you point out the trailer.
Yeah, there's a couple of things. One is about how successful the Mandalorian was. In its first week, it actually didn't do as well as people imagined it did. It actually only came in number 3.
Behind Titans and all that, yeah.
Yeah, behind Titans and Stranger Things, which has been out already for months.
That's weird.
And so the fact that it came in after, you know, a show that's already been out for months and months is not the strongest of showings. Now, that said, remember that this is a streaming platform, and so, you know, the ratings from 1 week aren't what determine the success of a show. You're going to be looking more at overall subscriber numbers, and they got 10 million subscribers in a day. So that's really decent. And as it's turned out now in the 2 weeks since then, or the week since then, it has moved up to be, the most popular online show of the year. So, you know, it's outstripped the other ones on Netflix and Amazon. So, so good on them. I mean, that they're, it's
showing
some...
Do they count the
some,
free week, you think?
Well, that's one of the things. I mean, even though I'm congratulating them, we don't know all of this for sure, because of course, when it comes to a subscription-based model of for determining success for a show like this, it's about how well you retain subscribers.
And, right.
You know, there was one article I read today that was talking about how the number of searches on Google for "how do I cancel Disney Plus" is really high, higher than that of people similarly searching for how to cancel Netflix. And so that's a little bit of a concern, because it may be because people were only doing the free week and right. then were trying to cancel, or, you know, it just doesn't have staying power. I think the truth is probably somewhere in the middle there.
Yeah, probably.
We'll probably continue to see strong numbers for Disney Plus. You know, we also know that Disney Plus is going to be introducing a lot of other new content in the coming month. And the coming content will be more adult friendly. So it'll be a lot more stuff that are sort of on the order of the Mandalorian, as opposed to, you know, kid friendly stuff. I remember we talked a little bit last week about how, you know, that's why Disney acquired Hulu, to put more of their adult content there.
Yeah, we hit you on the regular show.
And another reason why I think they had such low ratings was there for a while. It was hard to even get on Disney Plus because they kept having glitches. And that's not
sure, but remember that the ratings we're talking about here aren't actual ratings for viewers. It's about how much people have been talking about it online, and that because that's the only kind of metrics that are available, because all the streaming services keep this information private.
And I have a theory.
You also have to admit that a lot of this is from Mandalorian being an unknown quantity. All of the trailers for the Mandalorian, although they look good, really didn't tell us what the hell was going on.
No, but the hype was pretty high.
The hype was big enough. I don't think you can get away with saying it was an unknown
quantity.
But
let me offer a theory, though.
It is a very known quantity.
I know a lot of people I've talked to, and just a lot of people, even military people, and some people get paid biweekly, and some people get paid monthly. They get paid on the first. And there, a lot of people I know prefer to start their subscriptions around the same time that all their money's in there and it comes out and they can calculate it. And they started this one in the middle of the month on the 15th. And I think that, honestly, that is a factor as to what people might be temporarily canceling. And that's going to cause the metrics to be a little off, and they're going to resubscribe so they have control over when they get billed. I think you're going to find that is an actual thing, because they're in the middle of the month is not a good time.
Maybe. I mean, because the whole secret here, again, is this is not broadcast television, where you have to perform, you know, on the day of release. The performance here is measured in how well you retain subscribers over a long term.
Right. But they start at 15th.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we have plenty of time. You know, if you start looking at numbers like how many people are doing the full year sign up for Disney Plus, because that's the cheapest way to get it, that's a pretty compelling number. So, I mean, we don't know yet. I mean, all these things I'm bringing up are just little red flags to keep watch out for. Doesn't mean, I don't want to make them too big of a deal, but it does. But it's also something we should watch, because they could mean something. So
you could pin in it and watch it.
Yeah,
I honestly think it's going to take at least a year to get the true feel
It'll be a lot sooner than
and like
year.
I said, because
there's only eight episodes. There's only eight episodes, George.
Yeah.
So we'll know sooner than a year.
Yeah. Well, that's true. I'm just saying, like I said, like, people that subscribe to any of these shows or streaming services, when they get billed is important, and having control over that.
We get your point.
By the way, real quick, I did find out that, because they're timing all this, so when Mandalorian ends, they know that people need new content, so that's when the Marvel stuff is going to start coming out. Mm-hmm. And the thing I found out was the show length is going to be the same for all these shows, like 30 minutes, 20 minutes. They don't seem to have any hour-long things coming. which I guess it works, but what do you guys think about that? The Marvel stuff's going to be just as short, 30 minutes, 20 minutes.
I think you'll see some of that coming along. I mean, right now they're doing the two extremes, Disney Plus is. They're either doing, you know, essentially about half hour. I mean, they're not really half an hour. If you're talking about like 39 minutes, that is almost...
It has jumped up in there between 27, 39, whatever, you know. Yeah, I know what you're saying.
The point is, it's not that far off from a network drama, which is around 42 minutes.
Which is like Doctor Who length, basically.
So, so it's not necessarily less. It just seems less because there's no commercials and, you know, so you're seeing everything all at once. So, you know, a network hour is about 42 minutes. So it's not far off of that. So that's the first thing. And then I think the other thing, oh, I'm sorry, I forgot what the other thing was, and I'm not blaming you for this one, George. This is all my brain.
Okay.
So I'll just leave it at that. You know, right. I remember what I was going to say, that they're doing the two extremes, either the really short things, or because at the same time on cable and streaming, an hour show is truly an hour show. Game of Thrones, you know, most of HBO's things are truly an hour, sometimes a little bit more. So things like Watchmen and His Dark Materials and Game of Thrones, all of those are full hours. So if we're really, really comparing apples to apples here, then it is fair to say it's pretty short. We have the other end where they're doing like almost feature length stuff, like The Lady and the Tramp and all, and they're obviously leaning very heavily on their legacy material, which is all feature length as well. So,
right.
But I think all of this is going to be temporary because it's easier to ramp up a half hour show than it is to ramp up an hour long show. And so in order to get the right balance between quantity of shows and quality of shows, they're going with shorter shows to begin with, the occasional longer movie. I think as it gets going, you're going to see a lot more hour long shows.
You know, honestly, I like delivered. I've gotten used to Mandalorian, like short but sweet kind of thing. It's not really that short though. People are used to thinking like, Doctor Who's about the same length. So if you take out commercials,
but the thing is, it doesn't make sense for them to just stick with that. It just doesn't because none of their competitors do that.
I mean, that's true.
You know, I mean, Netflix has the occasional half hour long show. But most of their shows, their bread and butter shows are hour long shows or features, or feature length things. So if they're truly planning on competing with Netflix and the like, they're going to go ultimately with more of the hour long dramas. Same with Amazon. Amazon has a few shorter length things. The Julia Roberts Homecoming series is a good example of that. That's only half hour long. Really well done. Remember that the whole reason they do half hours so they can maintain quality but keep down spending. So, right. So it works from that perspective. But the majority of their own stuff, The Boys, Jack Ryan, all of those are hour plus shows.
All right. Well, I want to thank everyone for joining us tonight because we had a good little healthy debate.
Yeah, it was fun.
I mean, there's nothing wrong with a healthy debate, opinions, whatever. And it was a good episode to talk about. And Sun's caught up now. And we know that Gina Kerr is
on one of these shows. It turns into a 2 and 3 hour thing. So
it did run longer than what we intended for this after show. But I think that's only because there was a lot of other news about it. Whatever. Follow our Trello. If you see a lot of news that goes on top of the episode, you can guess it might go a little longer. But we'll see. All right. So anyways, so episode 3, The Sin. And you know what? I can't wait. There's only like, how many, 5 more episodes left? Yeah. No.
What's the next episode?
Nobody knows.
Nobody knows.
They don't do promos, except we know that Gina Carrera is debuting in this.
Dude, I just posted.
I know, but all we know is
plot synopses for the next 3 episodes.
Oh, it's the next 3 episodes? I didn't see that.
Don't you read the Trello, dude?
I did. I didn't see next 3 episodes.
It says in the big headline part, episodes 4, 5, and 6.
See, guys, I am going to now look at... You guys go look at the Trello. I'm...
George.
This Carlos, what's the next one?
The next episode is next Friday. and it is chapter 4. We don't have
subtitle for it yet.
But we know that the Mandalorian teams up with an ex-soldier, presumably that is Gina Carano, to protect a village from raiders. So we're continuing the kind of Kurosawa Western theme that we've been talking about so far. That's a very, you know, Kurosawa kind of plot. But she's a series regular, and we're going to be meeting her next in the next episode. So that's on November 29th, this coming Friday.
They
usually come out just a little bit after midnight Pacific time.
Yeah, sometimes they're late. Like I was out for me Eastern time at 3 a.m. It turned out PCs and some other platforms were having a huge delay because their servers were having certain issues. I had to wait till a half hour later for it to drop. I kept refreshing. I was staying up late. I was pissed off. But then I lit on Twitter. They said, I guess they're having a delay unless you're on iPhone or anything but Android and PC. And I'm like, great. Fire Stick was all set.
I eventually gave up and just went to bed. And I was like, I'll just watch it in the morning.
I was German. I'm like, fuck this. I'm going to keep hitting refresh. Half hour later, I got it. But, you know, anyways, hopefully that doesn't happen next week. But, all right. So we'll talk about the next episode when we get to it.
Sure. A couple of program notes real quick. For those of you who are tracking all of our upcoming podcasts on Trello, the info on the next three episodes of The Mandalorian is all on wherever you see coming up on The Mandalorian. If you click on that Trello card, you'll see a photograph and the short plot synopsis for that episode on there. So that's through for 4, 5, and 6 coming up.
And hopefully Mushroom Man comes back. Toad Man, hopefully comes back.
We're definitely going to see Toad again.
Well, we do know he does go back to that planet at some point because he has some unfinished business with Carl Weathers and Nick Nolte. Well, unless they go off planet.
Now you all got me in the mood to play Mario.
All right, you guys. Thank you for joining us for this Mandalicious. This Mandalicious. Juicy episode, and
play us out, Justin.
This is the way. Everybody say it. This is the way.
I have spoken.
This is the way I have spoken. God, they make some great catchphrases. So far, they've got two great catchphrases.
We're talking over it.
Well, this is the way I stop the stream. Peace out.